This week on Cracked Science, what to do if you want to spend $250 to find out if you have back hair. Hey, this is Jonathan Jarry, and you're watching Cracked Science, the bi-weekly show from the McGill Office for Science and Society that separates sense from nonsense on the scientific stage. Let's talk about your genes. No, I don't mean the $1,600 pair of distress pants you bought online and seriously hope your significant other won't find out about. I mean, of course, the bits along your DNA that help make you, you. If I ask you to guess who is running the largest genetic study ever, you may think of a university, maybe Harvard or one of the universities of California, of which I am reliably informed there are now 57. The actual answer may surprise you. It's 10. They have 10 campuses. No, but the people running the largest genetic study ever are 23andMe, the company whose motto, "Welcome to You," sounds like the name of a bad romantic comedy from 2003 starring Matthew McConaughey. 23andMe is a company that offers direct-to-consumer genetic testing. This means that you no longer have to go see a medical doctor to gain access to your genetic information. You can go through a business. Before we talk about what 23andMe is now planning to do with your genetic information, and yes, I mean you, as you may be one of the company's million-plus customers, we need to talk about direct-to-consumer genetic testing, its promises, and its reality. It is an industry that is predicted to grow to $340 million American dollars in the next 5 years, and is appealing because genetics is cool, unless portrayed by Hollywood, and because we all feel a sense of entitlement over our genetic information. So let's look at what a customer of 23andMe gets for the price. And keep in mind that there are other companies offering similar services. But to simplify, let's look at the most popular one. 23andMe will have you spit in a vial, they will extract your DNA, and they will test it for a long list of variants that can be found throughout your genome. You will get back a whole slew of reports. Some are about non-health-related traits. For example, and I am not making this up, they will test to see if you have the DNA variant associated with back hair. Note, available for men only. Sorry, ladies, you're really missing out on that one. Other traits that you will be informed about include whether you have light or dark hair, what your toe-length ratio is, and whether or not you have a unibrow. Keep in mind, you are paying good money for information that an ancient Roman could have figured out using their eyes and a bronze mirror. But more importantly, you will get reports on mutations you may carry that could cause a disease in your child, a disease like cystic fibrosis, and reports on risk factors for things like Alzheimer's disease. Now, back hair aside, you may believe that this is valuable information, but many scientists disagree. For example, you may think that the information contained in your genes is highly predictive, the same way that the phrase, "a film by Michael Bay," is predictive of, and I quote a popular movie critic, "an awful lingerie and beer advert that will carry on forever." But the truth is, the idea that every disease is caused by a mutation in a single gene was very naive when first thought of. Here's an illustration of how much more complicated reality is. The small area in green represents the kinds of diseases that can be easily predicted based on genetics alone, whereas everything else is in a shade of red, meaning genetic tests do a poor job of predicting what will happen to you. It's like an average person betting on horses. Sure, it's easy to figure out that this horse would never win the race, but if every other horse looks like this instead, the average person will have a hard time betting on the winner in advance. And here's a table that shows how much influence genes have on complex diseases like prostate cancer and type 2 diabetes. These are diseases that are influenced by more than one gene, as well as by your environment. As you can see, apart from a few, none come close to 100%. Then there's a problem that different testing companies will give you different risk profiles based off of the same DNA. The U.S. Government Accountability Office sent the DNA of volunteers to four different companies back in 2006 and wrote that these fictitious consumers received test results that are misleading and of little or no practical use. You can see, for example, that one volunteer was told that his risk of prostate cancer was average by two genetics companies, below average by the third, and above average by the fourth, which makes these results as reliable as a Ouija board. And the people who man the phones at these companies may not always be statistically literate genetic counselors. Here's a phone exchange between an undercover agent of the Government Accountability Office and one direct-to-consumer genetic testing company.
So if I'm high risk, does that mean I'll definitely get breast cancer?
You would be in the high risk of, pretty much getting it, so.
Oh my God. This is what happens when DNA companies hire Ms. Cleo to do customer service. Now, the risk profile I would get out of a test like this is already dubious. But if you are African American or Asian, you may be extra disappointed. You see, to interpret your risks, these companies need a baseline in your ethnic group, because how common a variant is changes from population to population. A piece on website Quartz mentioned that 23andMe issued a report to its Korean writer in which the writer's genetic profile could only be compared to 76 Koreans, which a geneticist called a really low number. Yeah, no kidding. In fact, a number of risk assessments made by companies like 23andMe are based on population studies done on white people. This is not the fault of the businesses themselves. This is an artifact of the bias of the basic research that is being done. Now, happily enough, 23andMe received nearly $2 million from the US government to fully sequence the genomes of many of its African American customers, so that this white bias in genetics research can start to be rectified, and we can move away from things like your profile could only be compared to 76 Koreans. So, to summarize, low predictability of the tests, useless information when it comes to traits, different risk assessments depending on the company, less information if you're not white, and Ms. Cleo answering your questions. But once you are done worrying about your slightly increased risk of developing prostate cancer, you can gloss over your custom health report from 23andMe that may state the following. These habits made the biggest difference in people with your genetics, limiting red meat, avoiding fast food, sleeping a healthy amount, eating vegetables, and exercising. Thank you, science, for providing me with highly personalized advice that does not apply to anyone else. If you and four of your friends were thinking of spending $250 each on this, you might as well pool your money and buy an ivory butt scratcher.
Butt scratcher? Butt scratcher? Get your butt scratcher here. Butt scratcher?
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 But even if you don't give your DNA to 23andMe, it remains the largest genetic study ever, and the company has recently decided to do something interesting with this information. Drug discovery. No, the company cannot look at your DNA and know that you like to smoke some ganja while watching Up in Smoke. But they can look at a drug that already exists and that targets a particular gene, and try to find out, by screening their vast library of DNA samples from people like you, if some customers have both an interesting variant in that gene and a particular disease. Because it could be that that genetic variant causes the disease and that the drug could help treat this disease. And I think this is a great initiative, though we shouldn't have unrealistic expectations, as drug discovery is notoriously difficult. For example, any researcher who is teaming up with 23andMe to look for associations between customer characteristics and their genetic information will have to rely on self-reports. For example, if you want to look at customers of 23andMe who have clinical depression, you depend on these customers accurately self-reporting their diagnosis of clinical depression. Some may not be willing to share this information. Others may feel sad and think that this is clinical depression. This is something that researchers must be acutely aware of when partnering with 23andMe. But it is certainly ironic that while many people expect to be paid to participate in research studies, customers of 23andMe are willing to not only give them their DNA, but to pay them as well for the privilege, and all for the pleasure of finally finding out the answer to the most important question in the universe. Do I have back hair? Yes, Andy Garcia. Yes, you do. That'll be $250, please. My recommendation this week is a very comprehensive piece about 23andMe by Erica Check Hayden and published in the journal Nature. It's called The Rise and Fall and Rise Again of 23andMe. It covers ground I didn't have time to address, such as the company's bizarre response to the FDA and an interesting portrait of the woman in charge of the company, who seems to have taken inspiration from Mark Zuckerberg when designing her nameplate. That's it for this week. I'll be back 2 weeks from now with a whole new show. In the meantime, don't forget to comment, like, subscribe, and check out our website at mcgill.ca/OSS.